The French say that the more things change, the more they remain the same. The truth is exactly the opposite. The more things change, the more they change. And we're going to be talking tonight about some very significant changes in the way we tell the news now, the way Americans communicate to other Americans about what's happening and what it means, and what they should think and do about whatever it means. My guests are all news industry people, or information industry people. We can no longer call them newspaper industry people. Though, indeed, Bill Adee works for a great newspaper, the Chicago Tribune, where he is the digital editor. He's in charge of a great deal that the newspaper does that isn't in ordinary print, as we'll learn shortly. Owen Youngman was a major figure at the Tribune, senior vice president for strategy and development, and more recently has shifted to the Medill School of Journalism, where he is professor of digital media strategy. That digital as an adjective is something we'll hear a lot tonight, I think, because, in fact, Brad Flora, our third guest, is the founder and editor of a great digital presence on the Internet. I'm not quite sure what we call it. It's a site, certainly, windycitizen.com. We don't call it a blog. It's a sort of a collection of blogs, is it not?
It's a social network for people that love Chicago, and they vote and rate and share their favorite local news and events.
Is there a social network for people who hate Chicago?
Not that I know of, but plenty of them find their places on the web as well.
How about a social network for people who hate much about the government of Chicago and are rather put off by Mayor Daley and his works and ways?
Lots of blogs out there that handle that, I think.
We get a lot of those people on Windy Citizen. So they find a voice on there, and they're able to promote their blog, their favorite news, and things that cover viewpoints that they don't typically see in the mainstream press.
One of the great indignities that has been visited upon the body politic of Chicago is what they've done with parking in town. I know lots of people are very angry about it. I might return to that topic in a while as a local issue to see what we're doing with it in the various media. But let me go back to newspapers and the basic question about whether newspapers are dying or diminishing and how other media are replacing them. The man to ask about all of this, he probably has some numbers in his head, is Owen Youngman.
Well, clearly newspapers are changing dramatically and have been since the dawn of the interactive era, say when AOL started to make deals with newspapers like those in the Tribune Company in 1991-92. What has really happened in the newspaper industry is that those people who were used to having untrammeled control of their markets suddenly found themselves competing with people all over the world and no longer in control of their fates. And they've been adapting slowly, too slowly in many cases, to a world where they actually have to listen to their advertisers and listen to their readers in order to do a good job serving them. Over time, this is going to make for stronger, more vibrant news organizations. Again, I won't call them newspapers either, although that's a key form of their expression. The changes, at the end of the day, should be positive. We're in a really tough period economically now, as you can see by just looking at the major papers that have closed up shop within the last year in Seattle and Denver, and those that are threatened, like those in Chicago, like the Chicago Sun-Times.
Indeed, last night, one of our guests was our dear old friend, Dick Ciccone. He used to be the managing editor of the Tribune. And Dick was predicting privately that probably the Sun-Times will be going under in rather short time.
Well, I think that Sun-Times Media Group, which includes a lot of different properties in Chicago market, Pioneer Press, a lot of the dailies in the old river towns that have been around, some of them longer than the Tribune, parts of the Sun-Times Media Group clearly will survive, but their amount of cash is dwindling so much, Milt, that they may wind up, I can't predict for certain, having to switch from Chapter 11 to Chapter 7 and liquidating and selling off their assets.
Experts, self-proclaimed experts on the news industry, who may not know as much as either or all of you, sometimes say to me, and I've heard this more than once, the newspapers have to die because people under 30 don't read newspapers at all. Is that in any significant sense true, Bill Adee?
I don't think so. Red Eye here in Chicago is arguably the most successful newspaper launch in
the last
10 years.
The counter there would be, well, that's not really a newspaper. It's a tabloid sheet that you give away for free.
There's news in it, and people like reading it, and it's a very good vehicle for advertisers too. So, and not only that, people still read the Tribune, plenty of them. 800,000, 900,000 papers sold on Sundays. So it's also a very popular item with under 30, over 30, you name it. So I'm not buying that.
Paid versus free as a differentiator is really a canard. Really, the cover price of a newspaper almost never has covered its actual cost. It was priced in such a way to get the maximum number of readers in to satisfy advertisers. It happens that the price that will bring in the maximum number of readers to papers like Red Eye is zero. And the day that Red Eye took its cover price off was the day it became profitable.
Let us now talk about interactive media or digital media or what's on the Internet. I'm not even sure what the proper vocabulary is. I'm an old fuddy-duddy, and I'm not up to all the latest developments. But I know, because I poke around on my own computer, though not with iPods or anything else, and look at all sorts of locations, all sorts of sites, I see there's an awful lot of news being ladled out, and even more opinion, and much argument, and a fair amount of insult as one reader reacts to one who was just the preceding one on the discussion rundown after somebody's printed an opinion article. So they call each other vile names and get angry, and they have they flame out, or they have
they flame
rants.
One another. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. And that's sort of fun in a way, but it distracts you from what's really happening and what does it really mean.
I think that in Chicago, you've got a particularly vibrant community of people who are both contributing to blogs and sites like Windy Citizen or Chicagoist or any of the Tribune sites or SunTimes.com. And they are contributing to a dialogue that may not always be elevated, but reflects their strong interest in Chicago. What news organizations need to do is to harness that energy if they're going to remain relevant and continue to lead public opinion, which, after all, is the job of journalism, not making a press turn, but to help people make the decisions that allow them to govern themselves in a sovereign nation.
Now, Mother Tribune, as she is often called by people who work in this building at least, does have many different presences on the Internet, but also there are things that arise independently. And Windy Citizen is one such, and I've been looking at it only over the last few days. And after we do what properly should be done on commercial radio, pause for some commercials, I want to talk about Windy Citizen.
Great.
And look at its invention, its mounting, and what's going on with it. And then related operations of that sort, of which I gather there are many right here in Chicago, and hundreds and thousands the country over and the world over. So we'll begin to plunge into Internet journalism, Internet opinion vehicles, Internet, what else do? They deal in news and opinion and what else?
Information on the way to becoming knowledge.
Which is not necessarily news, but where do you get a good hamburger in Chicago?
That's part
of information of a sort.
Well, that's news to someone who's hungry.
I guess it is. At any rate, we'll turn to all of that to begin with from Brad Flora, the founder and the editor of WindyCitizen.com, right after these words. And we return to three men of the modern media, of the Internet media and beyond, for maybe ultimately there will be yet another way apart from the Internet. But what that might, well, the telepathic media, that's yeah, coming next.
That's right. Hack the Spew. There was a great article, a story in Wired 15 years ago about people just sort of jacking into a stream of information directly to their brains. That's where we're headed.
Augmented reality.
Yeah.
But right now we're talking about the site that is represented by Brad Flora, who's with us tonight, WindyCitizen.com. And we've agreed that we call that an aggregator.
Yes, it's a social news aggregator that gives you the best 10 headlines from across all the Internet pertaining to Chicago, blogs, news
sites.
How do
we determine what's the best 10?
Well, the way we determine it is all of our stories are headlines submitted by readers, by average Chicagoans or people living outside of Chicago who love Chicago and follow local news. And we then let them vote on those stories and determine what they think are the most interesting ones. So it's a Chicago front page built by Chicago readers rather than built by editors or journalists.
And that's a powerful model. It's working well in the national space for a number of companies like Dig.com, which does the same thing nationwide, and which if a story is featured on Dig.com and enough readers vote that they like it, it can drive huge amounts of traffic for a site like Chicago Now or Windy Citizen or even ChicagoTribune.com. Right, Bill?
That is correct.
So with Windy Citizen, we help people find the best and most interesting news, opinion, upcoming events, funny things that showed up on Craigslist. And so it's a front page tends to be a really good mix of big mainstream news that's on the major sites, but also random bits of information that you wouldn't find anywhere else.
Milt, you talked about how digital is a big word, but just as important, and it has been for 20 years, is interactive. And that's really what we're talking about here. The interactive nature of the conversation, the two-way nature or three-way or 20-way among people who are gathered around a piece of content and talking about it is what's driving the vibrancy of the online media and is challenging journalists to find a way to participate in ways other than leading, which is what they were used to doing for the previous 150 years.
Well, I've just brought up, with a little difficulty, but I've found it now, WindyCitizen.com.
It's good for you.
It's on the screen in front of me. And the first one is missed connection of the day. Quote, you conducted my STD test. I thought you were hot. That's the highest ranked story, is it, for the
moment?
Yes,
indeed.
The second one is analyzing Helen Schiller's response to the Uptown Riot controversy.
And I'll point
from
out
Chicago Now.
Yeah, that's a link from Bill's website.
And guess that's what, a great story. I read that tonight.
And listen to the third. Guess what the third is? Tell Chicago, Windy Citizen will be on WGN Radio's Milt Rosenberg Show tonight at 9.
That's there you right. go. We covered all the bases right there top three.
You can did you write that one yourself?
Yeah, site. So I posted that. So we have this community site where anyone can post news and things that they think are interesting, and people came along and voted those stories up.
And then you have comments from readers.
That's right.
And on the story about your being on this program at this very moment, we have six discussions, it says. Who's going to be getting cooked in the photo above? Flora's on the Tribune, guys. I don't understand that. Could you explain that to me?
I posted a photo when I posted the link of a cooked goose. And one of our readers was curious if that was representing myself or the quote-unquote Tribune guys who were also going to be on the program tonight.
The second comment from Tamale Chica.
She's one of our top users.
She says,
she's a great local blogger.
Brad, not that you don't know it already, but this is great exposure for you. Rosenberg is picky about who he lets on the air with him.
Your reputation precedes you.
Just a crotchety old guy who doesn't let everybody on. That's true.
Story about that analyzes Schiller's response about the Uptown quote-unquote riot on Sheridan Road a couple of weeks ago is a good example of how digital media, interactive media, are letting people get points of view and facts in front of a broader audience that they never could do before or not do very easily.
Yeah.
It's important that people have these outlets, and in many cases they challenge the mainstream media to do a better job of covering stories like that and put some heat on politicians in the way that good newspapers have and people with opinions on radio and TV have always been able to do.
Now, I've just gone to Chicago Now.
There you go.
Which Bill Adee puts together.
The great Mike Doyle blogged about that.
I've got the page in front of me. Mike Doyle, where do I find him?
His little picture there is with his name, and he's the one who wrote. He writes Chicagosphere, which covers the blogs. It's a blog about blogs, essentially.
We should make clear, your site is essentially a collection of blogs.
Correct.
Blogs done only for Chicago Now.
Yes. So it is not an aggregator, it's actually a creator, although I would say
It's not an aggregator, it's a perpetrator.
Yes. It is, we really wanted to take some of the blogs that we really liked and create this network of great blogs. We also thought there were some topics that we should try to hit, and so we paired people with those topics. And then there were some just very interesting people we thought should have blogs, and so we taught him how to blog.
Isn't one of your bloggers our friend and our colleague here, Dave Kaplan?
Dave Kaplan is tremendous, and he's tremendous because I would find, Milt, I bet you'd be a great blogger because I think radio talk show hosts are excellent at this because they're used to finding, just boring in right on the hot topics. They do believe in interactivity, right? They take calls. And so Cap he's great. He's one of our top 10 bloggers.
Larry King, who does a nightly talk show, as we know, was the object of much condescending humor on the part of some people I know for the content of his column. He didn't write a blog. He wrote a print column. He probably still does, in which he would essentially talk about the good meal he had last night. And, gee, isn't so-and-so a great guy? There was nothing any deeper than that. It was just a statement of... It was rather like what you do on Twitter, I suppose, where you give...
Now, Milt, don't go off on Twitter. Twitter is great. Twitter is... Whatever you put into it is what you get out of it.
But let's be honest, that's a pretty apt description of the content on Twitter.
Yeah.
I disagree.
I had a really great bagel this morning.
That's the stereotype.
I cannot believe Brad is going to go down that road with you and stereotype Twitter that way. It is whatever you make of it, right? If you follow people who send out intelligent links, then Twitter's great.
But I've never
If you don't.
But what's the limitation they put you on Twitter?
Well, 140 characters.
Only 140 letters. Beyond that, you...
Well, I realize that sometimes that would be one word for you, Milt, but still, you can do a lot in 140 characters.
You can refer people to stories that could make a difference in their lives. Today, I was posting to Facebook and Twitter about a couple of stories, one in the Journal Today and one in the New York Times yesterday that sort of ran together. The New York Times piece was about devices that help three-year-olds learn to text. And the Journal Today had a piece about how the focus on texting among young people is denying them the ability to read one another's body language. And you put those two together, and you suddenly got an interesting view of the world. And you can actually communicate that in a tweet by using compressed URLs and get people to talk about it.
I learned today, looking at some materials that, in fact, our producer, Zach, put together for me, that journalists, even print journalists, are increasingly relying upon things like Twitter and Facebook because you get early flashes of news events, which otherwise you're not aware of, so that you can follow up quickly and make a major story out of it.
Absolutely.
The first report of the helicopter crash with the light plane over the Hudson
over
3
weeks
ago was on Twitter.
Yeah. Who put it there on Twitter? Somebody who saw it happen.
Somebody saw it happen.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's the same with Windy Citizen. You know, we get stuff that floats up our front page and then a couple of days later shows up on the front page of some of the major newspapers. A lot of times it'll be a YouTube video that someone captured and posted, and then someone will post it to Windy Citizen and it'll get voted up and reporters there see it and decide to explore it.
That touches on another fascinating angle about all the stuff that you find on the Internet, namely the omnipresence of videos now. It's just amazing what you can find. And it's ordinarily just collected by people with their own little video cameras, and they post them, and all the world has them.
Yep.
Because the bandwidth, they've got a lot of bandwidth available for fast uploads. And
yeah.
When I started in the Internet business in 1995, it took a long time to upload 20 seconds of Gene Siskel, and today you can do that almost instantly. But, you know, we're talking about things, Milt. I mean, as you know, I'm now at Northwestern teaching digital media strategy, and what that really means is that I'm trying to teach the journalists of tomorrow how to think about digital media and how to use them to do what journalists have always done,